You know, a fire burns for a long time,
but you have to feed that fire.
Amen.
In order for that fire to keep on burning, you've got to feed it. You see? We're specifically talking about the fire of God.
Amen.
The holy fire of God. See, I don't mind. There can be so many different levels of interpretation, so many different levels of understanding about the fire of God. The fire of God, when it touches you, it's not going to lead you to this extraordinary physical behavior that would appear to the rest of the world like you have lost your mind. Let me tell you, I've seen it one time on TV. Somebody actually showed me a video. Can you hear me there?
Well, after we stop recording, we'll see how it comes through.
We need this before that.
Yeah, you're recording right now.
See, and this man was given the word, and there must have been 20,000 people. Man, and he was, woo, he had the fire of God, and he was jumping up and down, and he was singing hallelujahs and everything and all that. And then, He said, look at me. Something happened to me. And he started making his faces. He said, Can't you tell? I've been touched by God. And I was like, man. And the entire congregation erupted.
What?
Yeah.
Wow.
This was a revival in Florida.
Wow.
Now, I'm kind of thinking that when the Holy Spirit touches you, especially when you are sharing what God is doing for you, through you, for the congregation and for His people, that there is going to be an extra sense of an ability to be comprehended and understood by all those around you.
Amen. Come on.
Woo!
Come on now.
Hey, you can't get in your thesaurus and your Persaurus and Vegasaurus and in your dictionary and memorize all these big deal words, and somehow you think it's going to be able to allow the people who you are ministering to understand the gospel. Let me make it really easy for you. One of the greatest men on the face of the earth to share the gospel and to preach the gospel to all the nations, Billy Graham. Billy Graham would stand calmly and collectively behind his podium and give you a 7-minute message. And thousands upon thousands of people would come to the Lord on that altar call. Thousands and thousands of people. Now that doesn't negate the fact or do away with the fact that God will use a man of God or a woman of God to perform miracles in front of your eyes so that you can see and know that and understand that what God is doing, he's doing on His own through the miracle working power of Himself because we believe. But it is not going to cause anyone at any given time to have the spirit of confusion on them. You see, this crowd and this area that we are in right now is so super hungry for the gospel of Jesus Christ. Not just the gospel of if you call upon the name of the Lord, you will be saved. Not just the gospel of God's going to give you a new life to change your life. But people around us have been hearing the gospel of Jesus preached like that for years. It's time for the people of the congregations of the body of Christ to not only come together, but to begin to learn how to operate in the miracle working power of Jesus Christ.
Yes.
You see, just believe will get you there.
Come on.
Now, see, there are different levels of striving for and different levels of understanding what you're striving for. See, you just might be able to do this God's thing. It just might be that God touched you one time, or you heard something, and the word came into you from the mouth of God, from the pastor or the preacher, and then went down into your soul, and that thing right there just busted some chains up off of you, and all you know is that you got touched.
Amen.
Well, then, see, then comes, there must come a purpose of the teaching of the body, the individual, the self, me, out of control. I can control my mouth. I can control my feet. Hey, I'll go for a while. I'm going to prophesy. I'm going to prophesy over my own body. I'm going to walk forward and then I'm going to walk backwards. Hey, now. I have control over me. The more that you get to know me, and the more that you get to listen and to hear me, as I begin to preach, the more that you will begin to see that I jest and I don't to use to make emphasis on some things and stuff. But not all the time are you going to get that, because sometimes it's meant for a few to understand with a deacon. But what happens is you begin to get on that narrow path. You see, you get to act any way you want. You get to perform in this great game of life, so to speak, on the great movie screen that you call your life, any way that you want to, when you're walking a wide path. When you're walking that wide path, you might even stumble upon a Holy Ghost pothole. Okay?
Amen.
And hey, you know what? You might trip. Come on. You might trip a little bit on that. Like, man, all of a sudden, man, you know what? I'm not even doing this church thing. And man, I don't even got a Bible at home. But all of a sudden, I just stumbled over something in the middle of my journey or in my path, in my walk, that caused something to happen inside of me. And it caused me to see that, man, I have this thing on me and in me. It might be kind of strange. I don't know what it is. That's what happened to me. You see, I begin to, on the wide path to destruction, I begin to see within myself, because I was observing me, because I was walking circumspectively, like the Bible tells us to do. We have to walk circumspectively. Circumspect means to look. Circumspectively would be like this. Would be this being in the middle of the road, and you walking around it and looking at it. Okay. This is what this does. See, you move on levels. You study it, and when you study it, you begin to see its functions. You analyze yourself. Through the Word of God, as you're walking that narrow path, using the Bible. See, the Word of God is the Bible. You use your training guide. You use your training guide. And everybody talks about the basic instructions before leaving Earth, right? You use your training guide.
Come
See,
on.
You don't get a new car without an operating manual. You don't learn how to run a new piece of machinery. Or me, I had a computer in my office. I don't even know how to run it. You know why? Because I had not allowed myself to sit down and to be taught. I hadn't read the book.
Come on.
That is when you read the book, things begin to happen.
Hey, old boy.
The narrow gate becomes clear. The do's and the don'ts. The ifs and the what ifs. The I can's and I can't. It's kind of strange that the more you read this, the more that you will begin to see that